I mean, if it ain't broke, why try and fix it? Why not leave schools if they're doing fine under local authority control?
Well, I think in the light of the debate in the House of Commons yesterday, I would have thought that Nicky Morgan would be taking soundings amongst her backbenchers.
Do you
already.
Think she'll change her
and
mind?
I think that she will listen to their concerns and to see how she can meet them. I'm not against academies. I started academies.
No, you're a big fan of them.
Back in the 1980s, I set up the first 16 schools free of education authority, city technology colleges. But I did it slowly. You can't suddenly make a school come independent unless the heads is capable of running it, running a budget, appointing staff, buying his own capital equipment. It takes a lot of time to get into that. And so I believe in the inevitability of gradualness.
Right. So is the policy wrong, this idea of imposing it on schools?
Well, I think that probably will be modified to some extent.
How do you do that? How will you modify that policy without actually just having to retreat completely?
I think the way to do it is to coax them. Because when Labour left office and the coalition started in 2010, there were only 200 academies. Now there are 4,700. The law hasn't been changed. People have seen the advantages. And people do realise that in some cases, a well-run academy can improve basic standards of schools. And so I would let that process generate that more actively, as it were. And there are problems, of course, acute problems, like small rural primaries. That was one of the points that was made yesterday.
So you would have left it alone, wouldn't 20. You?
I would let it... I'm in favour of academies, but I would encourage more of their development. The schools that I'm setting up, university technical colleges, are technically all academies. They're independent educational charities.
Yes. Do you think it's a bit unconservative, as Tim Lawton was saying, to actually force and impose this when give people choice?
Well, I think that's probably where it will end at the end of the day. I think there are great problems. There are now so many academies that you've got to have some intermediary body between the department and the academies. Because the department could not run 24,000 schools. They couldn't even run one school.
And so
that is why they have multi-academy trusts.
Yes, which would make it less centralised in that sense. But do you feel that the government's intention to remove the obligation to keep parent governors is also misguided?
Yes, I actually do think that is misguided, because I think parent governors add a great deal to colleges and schools. And you heard the Member of Parliament, who I think comes from Gloucester, saying exactly the same, that all his schools are academies in his area, but there are parent governors on it. And after all, a parent governor is part of the local community, the school is part of the local community, and certainly my colleges have parent governors.
Yes, so you'd like that bit to be dropped as well?
Yes, I think that'll be modified, should we say, yes.
There's a lot of modification going on this policy. And also, do you accept that by literally renaming a school, making it an academy, doesn't necessarily make it a good school, does it?
No, I'd agree entirely. It's not a question of names. An academy is good, it will be better, if in fact the managing team, the head and the governing body are determined to make it better and know how to make it better. And that's why I believe the inevitability of gradualness is the way to do it. And you have to train heads in this, you have to train governing bodies in this, so that they understand the complexity of running a school. And you cannot turn most schools easily into academies, because the most difficult and complex area is the financing of schools.
And the sustainability.
It is very, very complicated.
Were you surprised by the number of Conservative backbenchers who lined up to criticise this policy?
No, I think MPs take a great interest in education. They must. You know, they go to their schools, they see the parents, they see the children, and they're very involved with their schools.
Do you think this is showing more rebellion on the Conservative backbenchers?
Well, I think some of them are in rebellious mood in any case about the referendum.
Do you think that is what has allowed them to be a little more vocal?
I think it's a motive force. I'm interested in Ken Baker talking about the inevitability of gradualness, because that was the famous Roman general Fabius. After whom the Fabian Society, when I strike hard. That was the inevitability of gradualness. So you're a Fabian. I was also struck by how partisan this whole debate about education, if you think of it going back to when Kenneth was Education Secretary and subsequently, and Tony Blair wanted to make education one of his issues.
Education.
He said exactly that. My three priorities for government are that. And the following week, John Major was so worried about that, he said, on this platform last week, Tony Blair said his three priorities for government were education, education, education. Well, they're my three priorities for government. but not necessarily in that order.
That's quite a good joke, that one, isn't it? You remember that, can you?
I do indeed remember that. And I think education, I would love to take education out of politics, quite frankly.
Really?
Yes, and the colleges I'm setting up, the university colleges, are supported by all three parties. And I was very conscious, although the coalition was backing me, to get Labour to support it and Liberals, because those are the changes that survive.
All right.
And our colleges will survive.
Kenneth Baker, thank you. I think teachers might sign up to the idea of it being taken out of politics. They hate all that tinkering, as they
not
do.
Not necessarily teachers' unions.
Some teachers are very politicised, you know, no doubt about that.
Thank you very much.